Okay, so before I start, I think I also wanted to thank many people who have contributed to the work I've just told you and to the work I'm going to tell you about. So everything I showed you on evolution of networks, development, has been done with Eric Sigia, who was my postdoc supervisor. And also there was a contribution by Vincent Hakim, who was my PhD supervisor. Now I'm going to tell you about a completely different problem. It's completely unrelated. I'm going to tell you about immune interaction networks, where we could also get quite interesting results using our evolutionary algorithm. I'm not going to tell you too much about evolution this time. I'm just using more like a tool to study the problem, but I will give you the results of evolution and comment on that. All this work has been done with all these people. Grégoire Altambonnet is my experimental collaborator. We have a review in GIST at FIS, actually, which is supposed to be explaining a bit immune interaction networks for physicists. So if you are interested in what I'm going to tell you about today, you could check our review. There is a paper which is a model of immune recognition network, so done with also with Massimo Vergasola, and Guillaume Voisin is an experimentalist working with Grégoire. And most of what I'm going to tell you about has been done today has been done with Jean-Benoît Lalanne, who used to be one of my grad students, and Kyle, Laura, Thomas, Felix, Mathieu, also people from my group who have contributed in various places. So again, it's a completely different problem I got interested in, and the problem, so I'm going to introduce the problem with a couple of slides, and then we move to the blackboard because it's a field where you could do an interesting simple calculations. So the problem is basically the early immune response. So what happens in your body? So you can have an infection, and then you have many immune cells, somehow monitoring what is happening. And among these immune cells, you have cells that are called T cells. Okay. And so T cells, what they have are the surfaces, are receptors, have small receptors at the surface. And then the receptors interact with the ligands. And these ligands are basically, they are peptides that are around and that are characteristic of what is happening outside of the T cell or in your body. So some peptides are coming from yourself. So this is called self-peptide. So this is your own proteins, your own, basically it's you. And then when you have an infection, you're going to have peptides coming from viruses, from bacteria, and these are called not self-peptides. And so the goal of the immune T cell is to, you have ligand receptor interactions. So ligand is coming either from you or from, a virus, bacteria or something. And then you have receptors at the surface of the T cell. And based on this ligand receptor interaction, the T cell needs to know if it should trigger an immune response or not. And if it's you, it should not trigger an immune response. If the ligand presented is coming from a foreign agent, and again, a virus, say, or bacteria, then you should trigger an immune response, and then many things are happening. It releases things called cytokines. It's very complicated. But for now, I'm really going to focus on this very, very early process of detection, detecting self from not self, or sorting self from not self. So this is a problem I'm interested in. You have a T cell. You have many receptors at the surface of the T cell. It's roughly 30,000 per T cell. All the receptors are identical for a given T cell. So there is nothing special for one receptor. T cells have different receptors. So two T cells will have different receptors. Actually, you have a full repertoire of T cells with different receptors, but we're only going to focus on one T cell. And so the T cell at the surface, you have interaction with ligands. And the ligand can be self or not self. And the job of the T cell is to decide if the ligand is self or not self. If it's not self, it should trigger an immune response. If it's self, it should not trigger an immune response. Okay? Is it clear for us? So we're going to focus on this. Okay? Any question? Okay. So I wanted to show you a bit some data so that you have a sense of what kind of experiments you can do. So this is data from my collaborator, Grégoire Altambonnet. At that time, he was a postdoc with Ron Germain at the NIH in Washington, D.C. And so this graph here is plotting basically the response of a population of cell to ligands. So the x-axis, this is the number of ligands presented at a given cell. So it's PMHC, it's a technical name for the ligand. So this is in a log scale. So you can have from 0.1 to 10 to the power 5 ligands presented per cell. No, it's for any given cell. And then on the y-axis, this is in a population of T cell. How many, what is the frequency, the percentage of the cells that are essentially responding and triggering an immune response? And the way they measure it is via phospho-ERK phosphorylation. ERK is just a kinase and can be phosphorylated, and you can detect if it's phosphorylated. And if it's phosphorylated, we know that the T cell is active and is triggering an immune response. So now the three colors are for different type of ligands. So these ligands have, you know, kind of exotic names. That's the way it is. So these are different kinds of ligands. And so for instance, here, like, you know, this point here means that you present 100 Einfeld ligands to, on average, to cells, and then you see that basically, you know, less than 2% of the cell response. This is what this point means. Okay, so you see, and so these are three kinds of ligands, and you see that there are two very qualitatively different responses. So for the green and the blue ligands, you basically expose, you know, you put more and more ligands, you give more and more ligands to the cell, and essentially the cells do not respond. Maybe when you really, really load very strongly the T cell, you have a bit of response, but essentially there is no response. So this is what you would expect for self-ligand. You add more and more self-ligands, and the T cell is not responding because it's self, so it does not care, it should not trigger an immune response. Okay. So now the red curve is very different. So that's another kind of ligand. This is Sinfalk. And then you see that, you know, already when you have 10 ligands, only 10 ligands presented to a given cell, you already have 10% of the cells that are responding. And then you see, you know, you increase the dose. So you are, you know, not, you will never get 100%, but you still get something like 50, 60% of the cell responding. And clearly now, you know, qualitatively, this curve is very different from that curve. So this red curve corresponds more to not self. This is what you expect when you expose the T cells to not self ligands. It's going to be triggered, and you know, even for one ligand per cell, you start seeing a difference. You know, even one ligand potentially can trigger some of the response of some of the cells. And then, you know, like here, the whole population, 50% of the cell in the population have detected that this ligand is not self, and then they should trigger an immune response. So very qualitative difference. Again, this is basically self. This is not self. And so this is all done at the level of T cells interacting with ligands. Okay? So now the question you might ask is, what is the biochemistry, what is the biochemical difference between self and not self? I come back to that later on, but you know, there is one biochemical difference, and one thing you can do, so people, for instance, have checked this using chimeric DNA receptors. I skip that, and let's forget about this for now. So it's just to show you, you know, self and not self. I want to show you the other kind of data you can get, because it's also important to get a sense of you know, what is the experimental end-all you can have. So one thing you can do, for instance, is that you could look at, you increase the number of ligands you present. So agonist is the ligands that are triggering response, that would be not self. And you increase and you look at how, you know, what is, how many cells respond and what is the typical time scale of response. And so you see that, you know, as you increase the number of agonist ligands, you basically decrease the response time. That makes sense, because, you know, you have essentially more signal, and you have more signal, and so you can take a decision more quickly. So you see, at best, you take a decision in, you know, something like 50 seconds. So it's a relatively slow process, if you think about it. The cell needs 1 minute to decide if it's self or not self. So it's relatively slow. You know, it's not something instantaneous. It needs to take some time to make the decision. That will be relevant later. So it's relatively slow. But within 1 minute, you can take a decision. The thing you can look at also, you know, can look at cell-to-cell variability. So you can change the concentration of, say, CD8 on ERK and see how it modifies the response. So for instance, if you modify ERK concentration, that does not modify the response of cell. If you modify CD8, it's going to modify it in a very, very continuous way. You know, we can do that. You have phenotypic variability, so you have a sense of how the parameters are changing in the cell. And what also you can do, and this is what I come back to that later on, is that you can start putting different kind of ligands. So this curve here is obtained when you only put the same ligands and you increase the dose of ligands. But what you can do is that put different kind of ligands. So say mixture of self and not self, and see how the response of the cell respond. And you have this kind of weird curve. I'll come back to that later, but these weird curves are very characteristic of the system. Okay. So now this is it. This is the kind of data we can get, and the other kind of data you can get, I already showed this slide 2 days ago, you know a bit what the network of interaction is inside the cell, and this looks like this, okay? And as I already told you, it's actually a much more complicated network, so this is a full network of interaction inside the cell. So this is what is making the decision. This network, in some way, this is what decides to trigger a response if you have self or not self. The curves that I showed you, they should be come from this model. You know, should be able to use this model and reproduce the curves I showed you. And so, of course, the question is that how do you do that? You know, it's really the question that really motivated me to get interested into this. How do you solve this problem? How do you solve this problem of distinction between self and not self using this complicated network? And another question you can ask is that can you make a much simpler network doing the same decision, for instance? These are the kind of questions that motivated me. Okay, so now I'm good. And I'm going to go on the blackboard and explain to you the theory of that. So I don't need any more the slides. Okay, so can we take this? I can start. Oh, it's okay. It's fine. I'm doing it. Okay, so what I've just shown you, I have this what I call this dose response curve. Okay, and so this is ligand, number of ligands. So I will call that L later on. And so you go from it's log scale. And so this is the percentage of responding cell. And so I told you there are two kinds of responses you expect. For some cell, you get essentially nothing. So that will be self. Okay. And then for some cells, you will get not self. This is what I just shown you experimentally. Okay. So now the question you can ask, and it's an important question, is that I told you there is self and not self, but what is the difference? Why are is the cell seeing a difference between the self and not self? And so the difference that you see is coming from only one, essentially one biochemical parameter. So let me define this biochemical parameter. So to do that, I'm just going to draw a cell, a T cell, and then I'm going to have receptor here. And my notation for receptor will be R, okay? So I have R receptor for the T cell, at the surface of the T cell, and then I have ligands coming and interacting with the receptor. So this is ligands. And my notation is going to be L. Okay. So at the surface of the cell, you have ligand-receptor interaction. And I can write it in a biochemical way. L plus R is going to give me a complex, ligand-receptor complex. I'm going to call that C. So this is, again, ligand receptor giving me a complex, C, okay? So there is going to be an association constant, okay? And then there is a dissociation constant, which I'm going to write as inverse of a time. Tau minus one is a dissociation constant. The other way to think about it is that tau is the binding time of the receptor, of the ligand to the receptor. So this is the important parameter. Tau is basically the binding time or lifetime of ligand receptor interaction. Okay. So why am I introducing tau? It's because tau is a crucial parameter to define, to discriminate between self and non-self. Essentially, you have two cases. You have a threshold. So I'm going to write this on tau C, like tau critical. It's a threshold. And it's around 4 or 5 seconds. And so what happens is that if the binding time of your ligand is basically roughly lower than tau C, then you have no response. So it's like self. Okay? So the self ligands, they don't stay bound very long. Yes? Okay, so response here. Okay. For one given cell, response will be, do I have phosphorylation, phosphoric. And so it turns out that in the population of cells, of T cells, it's really bimodal. Either you're phosphorylated, either you're not phosphorylated. And phosphoric means that you have been activated, and when they're activated, they are releasing, you know, many cytokines and stuff like that. One other way to think about it related to what I've just told you the hour before, like think about it as a bistable system. And so it exists in an on and an off state, and on phosphoric means activated. So this is what I mean by response. Okay? Now, when tau is lower than tau C, you have no response. When tau is higher than tau C, you have response. Okay, and if you remember from the graph, you could have response for a very small number of ligands. So you can have response for, you know, something like 10 ligands presented. Okay, and that's not safe. Okay? So that's what distinguishes self from not self, and that's the binding time. So now what I can do, I told you already yesterday that I like phase diagram. Yes? How was that measured? So it's a minimum. It's basically the concentration. What I mean by this is would be the concentration for which 50% of the maximum cell of the maximum proportion of cells are responding. You know. So if I say I have 60%, you know, when I have full activation, I have 60% of cells that are responded. It means that for if I present 10 ligands on average, half of the 30% of the cells will be activated. Of course, it's a stochastic process. That's why it's not. But you know, it's what really matters is that it gives you a scale. It gives you a scale in number of ligands of sensitivity of the system. And I'm going to use a more like continuous framework today, but everything can be made stochastic without any problem. Okay. So now what I can do. And this is where it's becoming a bit non-trivial. What I can do, I'm going to draw a phase diagram where on the x-axis, I'm going to put my binding time, tau. Okay. And then I told you there is a threshold around tau C, which is 4 or 5 seconds. Okay. So that's my x-axis. And then, the thing I can add, you know, you have these dose response curves. Okay. And so what I can do, I put on this and the y-axis ligand concentration, L. Okay, so it's going to be 1, 10, you know, 100, 1000, 10 to the power 4, 10 to the power 5. Okay, and now I can draw a line that I'm going to define it as a response line, which is basically maybe the line where I have, for given binding time, what is the number of ligands that are triggering where half of the cells are responding. And if I draw such a line, I basically, from what I've just told you, I basically get something a bit like that. Or maybe something like this, It's not exactly similar to what I've told you, but that's basically the general shape is the same. So here I have response. And here I have no response. And I have a kind of asymptote here, 1,000. Okay? So this is my phase diagram of the immune response. Okay, so far so good. You're still with me? Okay, so now there is an issue here. And this is where the problem lies, is that now imagine you are here. Okay. So in this region, you have no response even if you have 10 to the power 5 ligands. Now imagine I change a little bit the binding time. So I did not put a scale of the binding time, I should have, but it's basically we here, basically it's 1 and 10 will be here. No. Depend if you do a log or on a linear scale. Let's say we do a roughly log scale. So then what I can do, I can change the binding time by say a factor of 2 or 3. So if I change the factor times the binding time here, I'm moving this direction, times 2. Okay, and then suddenly the cell it can respond for there is basically a drop in the sensitivity of the cell. And basically, you get, you multiply the binding time by a factor of 3, and suddenly you multiply the sensitivity of the system by something like 4 orders of magnitude. So if you multiply tau times 3, sensitivity of the system to the binding to L, it's basically, 4 orders of magnitude. So it's kind of a bit, a phase transition or something. You change parameter, relatively small change of parameters. In biology, a factor of 2 is nothing. And then suddenly, boom. So qualitatively, the system is becoming super sensitive to 1 parameters. And so that's a mystery. How do you do that? It's really not clear how you can do that. And to make this a bit more explicit, I'll give you one example, a very simple example of time model, where to give you a sense of what you would expect normally to happen. So to do that, let's go back to actually what I've written over there. Let's look at this system, ligand plus receptor, that gives you a complex. Let's assume that. Okay, and so let's write down a differential equation of this, describing the dynamics of the system. So the dynamics of the system, and I'm going to focus on C. So C, C dot is going to be something like kappa, L minus C, R minus C, minus tau minus 1 C, basically. Just like standard mass action law will give you something like that. So now let's assume that you don't have much C, so let's assume that C is much lower than L and R. Just to make something simple, but you don't need to assume that. So at steady state, C steady state, you would find that it's equal to, so you see it's completely straightforward. There is kappa R proportional to receptor, and what is interesting is that you have L tau, the product L tau. Okay? Yes? It's because the total number of ligands, the ligands that are bound to the receptor and the ligands that are free. So if I define L as the number of ligands I put, L minus C is the number of free ligands. It's just, it doesn't really matter. Yes? Yes. Sorry? Yeah, tau represents the lifetime of the ligand receptor interaction. Yeah? Yeah, so it's like you had a class on stochastic process. Yeah. 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 Okay. Maybe I come back to that later about the relation between the time scale, clearly the time scale of 4 or 5 seconds and the time scale of response of 1 minute, which I mentioned already. I come back to that later. The answer to your question is that I will show you a solution, and the solution I will show you cannot work if I don't have at least 1 minute to make the decision. So this constraint certainly is the kind of networks you can find. But it turns out that the network we found is consistent with the time scale of response that we observe experimentally. But you're right, there is a connection, there is actually a very important connection between this binding time and the time scale of response, and this needs to be accounted for. But everything I will tell you today is consistent with the data. Okay? Okay, so I'm coming back to that. So I have this very simple ligand receptor interaction, and so at the steady state, the concentration of this complex is this what I've expressed here. And so now what you could do, you know, usually in biology, what is happening, you have ligand receptor interaction, and then the complex is doing something, you know, it's phosphorylated something, or, you know, it's cleaved or whatever, but then you expect the signal of the cell to be proportional to C, you know. If you have a situation like this, you expect that the signal to be proportional to C. Or to be related to C, maybe not proportional, to be related to C. Okay, so for instance, you could have a situation where you threshold C. You say, well, yeah, if I have C that is higher than some concentration, then I'm going to trigger a response. If I have C lower than some concentration, I'm going to have no response. So let us assume in this situation that cells respond if C is higher than C star, a concentration. I'm just saying there's a threshold, and then if I respond, if I have this C higher than C star. So now what we can do is that we have an equation. You know, if I go back to my phase diagram, I can write the equation of my line here. And so now my phase diagram would be, you know, phase diagram. It would be that you have, so now I have C steady state. Now at the boundary between response and non-response, it's equal to C star. So I'm going to have C star is equal to kappa R L tau. Okay? So that's my equation for the phase diagram. And now taking the log, so that means that log of C star is equal to log kappa R. Don't we care? What is interesting is that you have log of L plus log of tau. Okay? So now I can, you know, C star, kappa R, I know what they are. So I can plot in my phase diagram the equation of this curve here. And so basically the equation is going to be something like, so if I express, so for instance here I express L as a function of tau, so I'm going to have that log L is equal to log C star over kappa R minus log tau. Okay? So in a log L log tau scale, it's basically just a slope, and the slope is minus one. So if I plot what it is here, so assuming I am in log scale in this diagram, you know, you would expect something like that. No, something like this. So this is my naive model. Okay. Okay, is it clear for everybody? So now this is why it's a surprise. So you see what is the issue here. You know, in the naive model, you expect a slope of minus one. Where here, what you really have in reality is almost like a vertical slope. So how do you turn something, this is, you know, minus one, into a vertical slope? That's really the question I'm trying to figure out today. So, and I give you the answer to that, but this is really the problem we need to solve. Intuitively, what this means, you know, this slope minus one, what this really means is that imagine you have a signal, and think about any kind of generic signal where you have a ligand and then a binding time. It means if I want to increase the response to the signal, I can do two things. I can increase the concentration of the signal, or I could also increase the binding time of the ligand. So there are two ways, usually there are two ways to increase the output of a system in a biological context. This is exactly what is expressed here. If I want to increase C, I can either increase L or increase tau. But now, the fact that you have a vertical line here, what this means intuitively is that you don't, increasing L is not doing anything. The only thing that matters is tau. And this is not at all what you expect from any naive model. So this is really the problem we're going to solve today. How do we do that? How do we make a vertical slope? Okay, it's clear for everybody. Okay, so now I'm going to say one last word in terms of slope and all of that. So in 95, so people realize that relatively quickly, people in the immune field, they realize that the slope minus one is not good. You need something almost vertical. And so then, you know, how do we make something vertical? And so there is a simple solution of that that was proposed by a guy called McKithan in 95, which I'm going to describe now. And so, and this is the elaboration of ideas proposed in different contexts by John Hopfield and Jack Nino. And this is a famous kinetic proofreading model. I don't know if you've heard about it. So they adapted the kinetic proofreading model to this problem. So this is McKithan 95. So what did he propose? So let's start again with our ligand plus receptor interaction. See, now I'm going to call it C0, you'll see why. Okay, so we saw this is not correct solution, this cannot work. What he proposed is that now let's assume we have what we call proofreading steps. So proofreading steps that you add a irreducible step like this, C1. Maybe you have several of them. And this arrow could correspond to phosphorylation. You add a phosphate group, say, to the receptor when you bond to the ligand. And then what he proposed is that now imagine if you have this kind of biochemistry, where each of the complex here can go back right from the beginning to the unbound state. So this is called, this scheme are very classical in systems biology. It's called kinetic proofreading. And there are many ways to do that. I can tell you more about the biochemical ways to do stuff, but maybe, yes, okay. Yeah, you are from C1, you don't go back to C0, you go back from L to the ligand plus receptor thing. So I tell you biochemically what is happening. So biochemically, you have the ligand plus the receptor. Okay, so they give you the ligand receptor interaction. And then C1 could be this guy here where you have, so imagine this is the membrane of the cell. Imagine you have a phosphate group here. Okay, so now this thing here, the way it works is that now you can have the dissociation of the ligand from the receptor, okay? And this happens with binding time tau minus one, because it's just a constant lifetime of the, and so what that means is that this guy here is super quickly going back that, super fast. So you lose this P, you know, as soon as the ligand disappears, boom, the P is also disappearing because the idea that, for instance, phosphatases are rushing and dephosphorylating the tail of the receptor. Effectively, a model like this gives you just, you know, an unbinding with a tau minus one binding time. Okay? So this is the way you should think about it. These people have checked exactly that this is happening. This is known. In this context, this immune context, it is known that there are phosphorylation, and that our phosphatase is rushing to the phosphorylation sites when your ligand is unbinding. Okay? Okay, so now what McKeithan observed that now, imagine that instead of taking C0, you take Cn here. You know, you have n step. Imagine you take Cn as the output. And so how do you modify the C steady state? It's pretty straightforward, actually. So, I'm going to do with assumption, like you assume that things are, you know, like you kind of optimize parameters so that this works well. But what you will get is that Cn steady state will be roughly, so it will be proportional, there will be free factor in front of it, but it will be proportional to L tau to the power n plus 1. Okay, so basically what the effect of proofreading, so we had L tau before, but instead of L tau, we get the power of tau, we have L tau to the power n plus 1. So it means that if you do the same reasoning, imagine you take the decision if Cn is equal to a threshold, it means that the slope, that the response, no, in the phase diagram, you get something like log L is equal to some constant, we don't care what it is, and then what you get now, you get minus n plus 1 log tau. Okay? So the effect on this, on my phase diagram, is that I increase the slope. Yes? So here in this context, each receptor is completely independent. So you would just sum over the whole cell how many receptor in state N you have. And so if you have and non-specificity here would mean, for instance, that the tau are different. Okay? So like for instance, for safe ligand, tau is very small, so you basically don't stay, you know, you're not born. Okay? And then over the cell, you just measure how many of the, I know at any given time, how many of the receptor are in the state N, and that will give you this equation here. Okay? So now in this equation, so you see the difference with this now is that you increase the slope, so you get something maybe like that, you know, in idle. There's nothing particular in this point, you know, it just depends on the constants, but really what matters is that you change the slope. So it's slope minus one here, and then with the KT proofreading, you get a slope of minus n plus 1. Okay? So, and you see now from this, at least there is a solution to the vertical thing. If I increase n, I'm making the slope more vertical. If I take n equals infinity, essentially, I get something which is purely vertical. So that gives you a solution. If I take, and of course, infinity doesn't exist in biology, but if I take n big, maybe I can have something that will be consistent with the actual data. So that's what McKeithan proposed. He proposed that if you have enough proofreading steps, then you might be consistent with the actual response that we observe in the biological system. So that's a proposal. So it turns out that now you have to be a bit more specific and make calculation and check what is happening experimentally. Turns out that you can estimate how many N you would need to have something consistent with data. So to be consistent of data, and I give you the answer, to be consistent with data, you would need something like N around 15. You need 15 of these steps to be consistent with data, and that's coming from it might not be completely clear from what I've written, because there are prefactors and stuff like that. So that's the first problem. You know, if you do the exact calculation, this is what you get. And there is another problem, is that for this, it could be super slow. So that's an issue with KT proofreading models. It's a general issue. For this, to have maximum discrimination as a function of the binding time, you essentially need each of these arrows here to be infinitely slow. So to get something that is consistent with this, you know, 1 to 5 minute response time and the almost vertical slope, basically kinetic proofreading is not working. You don't have, for two reasons. You don't have enough proofreading, you know, possible phosphorylation sites at the tail of the receptor, and it's not consistent, not completely constant. 15 is big. And then even if you add, the system will be too slow. So it will take a long, long time to respond. Which is also an interesting lesson sometimes in biology. You know, people make, compute things like, physical bounds to do this and that, but the thing that in the immune system, especially, you need to respond quickly. So speed matters. And so it's, you really need to consider all constraints, speed, accuracy, sensitivity at the same time to build a proper biological model. So the proofreading model is not working. So we need to find another model to explain this vertical slope. Okay? So that was the situation of the problem. I mean, at least when I first got interested into this problem, that was more or less what it was, except that there was this big model that I showed you, like this big interaction network. And it turns out this big interaction network is actually doing the job. You can make a MATLAB model of this of these very complicated networks, and it does exactly the job of having the right response time, the right slope, all of this. And so you remember my title, Untangling the Airball of Immune Network, was really flagger-blasted by this, like how this network is performing this discrimination, knowing that a simple toy model like kinetic proofreading is not working. So I really wanted to get to the point, is it a network effect? You could have something like this. You could have, because it's a very complicated network, maybe, there's some kind of statistical mechanics things appear happening, a phase transition inside of the network, because you have many components that will give you this very, very sharp thing. That's what I got interested in that. Okay, so now to solve the problem, there are two things we did. So the first thing is that we were quite lucky. We found a way to actually, yes.
Transition,
yeah.
Diagram.
So, yeah.
Thanks. Then you went to the network. What was the motivating factor?
So somebody built a model, actually my collaborator, Grégoire Tambonnet, he built a MATLAB model with this big network that is having the exact phase diagram. And so I did not know how it worked, because if you look at the kinetic proofreading thing, it's not possible. And so you had something happening in this network that made it work. And I didn't know what. And so the question now is that, is it because it's a big network that it works? What part of the networks matter? I did not know. So that's what motivated me to get into this problem. Okay, so we found two ways to deal with that. We actually got lucky enough to find a minimum model a priori that was consistent with data. But I'm not going to tell you about this because it's a bit complicated, even if it's small. And what is more interesting is that we used this evolutionary computation to actually try to solve this problem, because I could now take a network, evolve the network in the computer, and try to build this phase diagram, evolve this phase diagram. And so I'm going to give you the answer that was found by the evolutionary computation. So I told you about this thing, so I don't need to introduce you the algorithm. And so I was very surprised to see that this problem has a very, very simple solution. Now let me draw what solution is and explain you why it works. So this was done by my student Jean-Benoît Lalanne. And so, we write the problem, we define the fitness function. I'm not going to explain you the fitness function because I don't really have time, and also, but it's not that easy to define the fitness function, and I can tell you offline about it maybe, but as you saw from the previous presentation, finding the right fitness function is important. But I don't want to spend too much time on this now. I'm going to give you simply the what the algorithm found. So the network topology it found is something like this. So this is basically, so it starts with proofreading. So that's really not complicated. So we were expecting some kind of proofreading, but you only have one step. So there was the first surprise that there is one step, and then there is something else. So here, in the KT proofreading cascade, there is a kinase. Okay, so there is a kinase that is an enzyme. No, phosphorylation are mediated by enzyme called kinase. It's phosphorylating from C0 to C1. So this one was evolved in the computer. And then what actually the computer evolved is this. The C0 here was repressing the kinase. That's it. This is a solution found by the computer. Very surprising, very simple. So I'm going to tell you exactly how it works, but you know, just in terms of observation, you know, first one observation, you know, relating this to the network motif and all of that. Here you have also another beautiful negate incoherent feedforward loop, because you have C0 goes to C1, and then you have this loop here, which is negative. So we get this negative feedforward loop. Okay, and so now what was happening? You know, why is it working? K is a kinase. It's just a kinase that is around. So K kinase. So I told you C0 to C1 is that you had one phosphate group, and these phosphorations they appear because they are enzyme, and the enzyme doing it is a kinase which I call K. Okay, so that's what happens. So what is happening? Why is it working? Why is it giving you my vertical slope? And so before I show you exactly what is happening, I give you an intuition of how this works. And it's a very simple intuition. It's basically already here. It's here in this thing. So how can I make a vertical slope with this? Well, okay. I told you that a simple ligand receptor interaction, okay, that gives me a slope where essentially log L plus log tau equals some constant, constant A. Okay, that's what it gives me. Now I told you, a kinetic proofreading thing. Okay, so the equation is going to be something like, so let's assume you have only one step of kinetic proofreading. So get log L plus 2 log tau is equal to B. Okay, so that's what a kinetic proofreading thing says. So what I'm telling you is that, so this guy has slope 1, this guy has slope 2. This is what I do. Now imagine, look at this equation. Take the difference. You do 1, 2, minus, okay? So what do you have? Now you get, the magic thing is happening, the L are disappearing. That gives you log 2, log tau, is equals to B minus A. Yeah, I should put minus A, whatever. Okay? And now I'm going to call that, well, let's call that log tau C, okay? Which is my critical thing. And now, if I were able to do the difference, I cannot define a critical tau, which is just B minus A. And then above, if I had a network able to make the differences, I would be able to basically fill directly tau with respect to tau C. So that's an equation. Now, in terms of, what could that mean in terms of network? Well, let's take back the exponential, and let's see what this means. It means that, what I'm doing here, I'm telling you that if I do L tau square over L tau, okay, because, I take the exponential, then that gives me the ratio. So if I can do the ratio of two of these slopes, then it's basically getting to tau. And then I can say, well, if tau then is higher than tau C, I do response. And then if it's lower than tau C, I do no response. Okay, so now what I need a network that is doing the ratio of L tau square over L tau. Can I build a network doing the L ratio L tau square over L tau? Can I do that? In terms of this network is exactly doing this. It's exactly doing the ratio of L tau square over L tau. So this network, C1, it's basically the ratio of L tau square over L tau. It's exactly what it's doing. And so now if C1 is higher than tau C, I get response. And if C1 is lower than tau C, I get no response. Okay? So that's the idea. This network is taking basically the ratio of two slopes, two of my slopes, one slope L tau square and one slope L tau. So you can actually identify exactly which part of the network, which part of the computation. So it's should be pretty obvious now, given what I've told you about proofreading, that this part of the network here, this is my standard Kimchi proofreading cascade. And basically this part of the network is a proofreading. So this part is responsible for the L tau square part. Okay, and now the part of the network that is responsible for the 1 over L tau is this part of the network. Our negative feed-forward loop is basically computing 1 over L tau. And then C1 here is making basically the product L tau square over L tau. And this is how I can make the immune recognition. Okay? So I can be even more explicit and write down exactly the equations if you want. Maybe I do that just to insist on it. So C1, if you write an equation for C1, C1 dot, it's going to be, so if you look at what happens here, C1 is only coming from C0 and K. So it's going to be something like a phi times C0 times K, and then there is a dissociation rate, minus time minus 1 C1. Okay, so at steady state, you get that C1 is equal to phi C0K tau. Okay, and now, what is C0K? Well, C0K, actually, this part of the network, C0 represses K. If you take a standard Michaelis-Menten approximation, you will see that K is basically proportional to 1 over C0. It's a constant, let's say it's beta over C0. There will be an epsilon here, but let's say epsilon is very small. Okay? So now if you put that back in this equation, you see that C1 is basically equals to beta phi C0 tau over C0 plus epsilon, okay? And now C0, it's basically, essentially, it's the first complex in the beginning, so my C0 is just my usual ligand receptor interaction, so C0 is essentially proportional to L tau. So C0 is proportional to L tau, roughly. I mean, there are little epsilon everywhere, but that's to give you an idea, and so this guy is basically beta phi, so C0 L tau, so it's L tau square, over C0 plus epsilon, L tau, let's put my plus epsilon. Okay? So that's what this thing is doing. So that works. That's very simple. That gives you your vertical slope. You can exactly do what I've described. You say if C1 is higher than tau C, I have response. If it's lower than tau C, I have no response. You exactly get this curve. This curve just coming out exactly like this from this simple model. So we're happy. We had the simple solution. But there is a catch. There is a big, big catch. So this is what is happening when you only have one kind of ligands here. Yes? Sure. Yeah, it curves because if you didn't have the epsilon, it would be a straight line. But that would be unrealistic. It means that you have response for zero ligands. But yeah, it curves exactly because it's epsilon. But like when I write this down, there is no epsilon because L is completely disappearing. By the way, the reason why L is disappearing is coming from what I explained yesterday on the feed-forward loop network. I told you it can be made adaptive. I told you it could come back to the same concentration irrespective of the level of the input. It's exactly what is happening here. This feedforward loop is working as an adaptive system. And for this reason, this network, we gave it a name. We wanted to give it a name like kinetic proofreading. So we call that adaptive sorting. This is to contrast it to kinetic proofreading. Then we realized it's a bad name. So Michael Elovitz told us it's a bad name. So we're probably going to change it to adaptive proofreading. Anyway. The reason is because biologists, and when they think about proofreading, is they really think about this. We realize that when biologists tell you proofreading, it exactly means that they are sensing the tau. So that's why we would like to say it's more like adaptive proofreading. Like, well, proofreading for me, I always hear kinetic proofreading, but proofreading means something else in biology. Anyway, that's the detail. Okay, so now I told you there's a catch. So the catch is that we realize that this network cannot work. The reason why it cannot work is because this is doing the job if you have only one type of ligand, one binding time. Now imagine you have two types of ligands. Imagine you have self-ligands and not self-ligands. So what this network would do if this is the case is the following. So now I told you, if I have L ligand L ligand of binding time tau, then the response C1 is basically L tau square over L tau, and this is equal to tau. So that's the easy case. There's only one type of ligand. Now imagine you have two types of ligand, L1 tau 1, L2 tau 2. Okay, so you take this network, and the important thing is that so the ligand, the receptor are going to be independent. Ligand receptor interaction are going to be independent, but there's a kinase here. The kinase is shared between all receptors. Because of that, if you look now at the total C1, okay, it's going to be equal to L1 to 1 square plus L2 to 2 square over L1 to 1 plus L2 to 2. The reason why you have the sum here is because you have the kinase that is shared with everybody. Okay? And so that's problematic, because now you can make the calculation. If you say you have 10 ligands, binding time tau equals 10, and if you have like 10 to the power 5 ligands, tau equals 1, okay? So if you say tau C is around 3, now you add 10 to the power 5 ligand tau equals 1, so look at what happens. Here you have 10, you make it 100, and here you have 2 to the power 5. So 100 compared to 10 to the power 5, you completely crush the response. So you have no response. Because L1 tau 1 would be much, much smaller than L2 tau 2. So you completely crush the response. So that's bad news. It means that you are able to make the detection if you have only one type of ligand, but if you have several types of ligands, you're dead. Your self is killing you. Your self ligands are preventing your cell to human cells to work. Okay. So there's a catch, but on the other hand, it's a good news. Because this is something that is known in immunology. It's called ligand antagonism. Okay. It's known that if you put a bit of ligands here in this region, a bit, I mean like 10 to the power 4, 10 to the power 3, and 10 to the power 4, if you make a mixture with ligands that are here, then they're going to lower the response and they're going to antagonize the response. So ligand antagonism is observed. So in some ways, it's also good news, because we get this network. And this network reproduces something that is well known experimentally, this ligand antagonism property. So, you know, it's along the line of what I said earlier today, that you get things coming for free in this evolutionary computation. We got ligand antagonism for free. It's coming from this model, and if you look at where it comes from the sharing of this kinase K between all receptors. So that was good, but that was bad, because quantitatively speaking, it's too strong. It was much, much too strong for this problem to work, but too strong. Okay, so then what do you do? Your model is kind of working, you know, it works. It's basically doing what you want, the coil phase diagram, when there is only one type of ligand. When there are several types of ligand, it's also doing somehow what you want, but it's just too strong. So how do you tame it? You know, how do you do it? And there are two ways to do it. So you go back to your computer, you redo your evolutionary simulation, but you give the constraint that you do the detection No, you're not doing 10 ligands tau equals 10 seconds versus 10 ligands tau equals 1 second to have your vertical line, but you do it in presence of self. So you redo your version computation to get something more realistic in terms of what the individual cells actually see, and you found the result. You found it. Or you are clever and you realize where is this problem coming from? It's coming from the fact that it's coming what I wrote here. It's coming from the fact that, you know, with these numbers, this guy is going to dominate these guys. Okay. And so how, maybe there's a way to do so that, you know, this is no longer happening. And then we realize there is actually a very, very simple way to do it, which is to use our kinetic proofreading thing. So how do you solve this problem? Okay, you do. Now you do. So I told you that adaptive sorting. Adaptive sorting, basically, you do L1 to 1 square plus L2 to 2 square over L1 to 1 plus L2 to 2. Okay, now how do you solve that? You do adaptive sorting with proofreading. And what I mean by this, with kinetic proofreading, what I mean by this is that you generalize this and you write this as L1 to 1 to the power n plus L2 tau 2 to the power n over L1 to 1 to the power m plus L2 tau 2 to the power m. So what that means is that you have your, you know, ligand plus receptor. You still have C0, C1, Cn. Then here you have Cm somewhere here. And Cm is basically replacing the kinase, the last kinase. So you basically move, you make a kinetic proofreading cascade, and you move this adaptive sorting module down the kinetic proofreading cascade. And the effect of that is that now if m is big enough, so imagine, sorry, m equals 2. You know, already m is equals 2. In this situation, you already gain one order of magnitude for m, for this versus this guy. And if it's relatively small m, then you can get something which is consistent with experiments, and that solves this antagonism problem. Okay? So that's our solution, adaptive sorting with kinetic proofreading. This is what it does. And so, of course, it generalizes. You know, I just took two ligands, but you can have several ligands. It's the same problem. And this model has everything you want. It has this slope like that. It works for pure ligands. Because you see, if you only have L2, you get L tau 1 to the power n minus m, but that's okay. It just doesn't really matter. And then it solves the antagonism problem. And you can show that if you still go very, very close to the threshold, you will still get antagonism. So this model explains all the data. It explains all the data. And I showed you some data earlier today, about showed you response time, and you know, what happens with mixture of ligands. This model explained all the data perfectly well. And in particular, the smoking gun, you know, the smoking gun is really this antagonism. You know, the antagonism tells you that there is something shared inside the cell, so that the ligands just below the threshold are somewhat antagonizing the ligand above the threshold. And this is what we observe here. Yes? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, tau c to the power n minus m. Well, you just change your network. Your network is computing this, okay? Your network is computing this. Your network C1, if you only have one type of ligand, it's basically tau 1, tau to the power n minus m. And then you just define your threshold based on this. So you say if C1 is higher than tau C to the power n minus m, you do response. And then if it's lower, you do no response. So it's the C1, Cn, sorry. Yeah, tau C is data.
So now tau, yeah. Parameter, yeah. Is going to be different.
Yeah? It depends on ligands.
Yeah. So tau would be log of tau C.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Log of Cn divided by n minus n. Yeah.
So now if you change your tau,
yeah.
So you are moving this
But tau c is given for any given cell, tau c is given and it's given by 4 or 5 seconds. So tau c is given. So then if you change your binding time, then you get above or below this tau c for that is measured via Cn. Okay? So what else do I want to say? Yeah, response time. Okay, so response time. So how do you deal with the response time? So it's actually pretty, okay, so, and it's related also to, so tau, clearly tau is going to be, you know, this Cn is clearly going to be quite small. You know, whatever you do, Cn is quite small. So that's a problematic because if you say Cn should be higher or above a threshold, you might have stochastic fluctuation that would give you, you know, that would give you something that has to be above or below threshold. So we need to complement that to something else to account for this. And so this is where we just, we did not claim that we, you know, we tried by hand to see what would work and what is easy to do. And so what is easy to do is that you say that Cn is activating downstream, you know, we basically say downstream that Cn is activating a species that you can call ERK, okay, but with a very slow time scale. Okay. So that ERK is basically computing, you know, if you choose it properly, ERK is basically the average. It's basically an average of Cn over, I mean, it's more like a convolution over the, okay, so it's basically something like this. It's integral of Cn of t minus tau, expansion of my tau minus tau, d tau, between t and minus infinity. Okay? Something like that. Did I write it correctly? So you can build a network like this. And you probably need something like a lambda, something like that. Okay, so you can build a network that is measuring this, that is doing that, and then you can check how long does it take you to make a proper recognition of your system, knowing that Cn is going to fluctuate a lot, you know, but since you're making the convolution, you're going to average out the fluctuation, and then you can get an estimation of how long it takes to respond, and then you see that within 1 minute, you make a perfectly good discrimination. So you find that, you know, for with 1 minute, 1 minute average, 1 minute averaging gives you the right decision time. And you also get, so if you do that exactly, you can now plot the response time as a function of the ligand concentration, and you get exactly the same kind of curve. So if you have a lot of ligands, you reach much faster the threshold, and you stay there, and you don't need to average this out. So it works basically. So we have not tried to really probe the exact limits of what you could do, like the minimum time, but the average time that you get is, and the orders of magnitude are completely correct. So that's also why we're relatively confident that our model works. Okay? Yeah, you can make it stochastic. Yeah, Gillespie, whatever, we've done that. We've done that. So, in terms of sociology or this model, we came it late, very late on this model. So we had done a previous model. So I can draw the model and you will see what it is. And you see, so the model we've done, inspired by experiments, and it's actually important that I draw it. So the model we've done is this. So it's ligand plus receptor. You do this C0, C1. So we had the same thing. Okay. And what happened the way, what, and this is what actually happened in the system. So there is, it actually, instead of repressing a kinase, it activates a phosphatase. And the phosphatase is doing this. Okay? So instead of activating a kinase, you repress a phosphatase. You repress a phosphatase. Okay, so this model is basically a deformed adaptive sorting. But I was not aware that this was the optimal solution. So the difference with this model and the full model is the following. So if you do a dose response curve, it's actually this curve over there. If you do a dose response curve for adaptive sorting, for the model that I plotted here, modulo the epsilon is going to look exactly like this. So it's like it's going to give you flat lines. If you do now a dose response curve for the model I have drawn over there, you don't quite get this. What you get is the following. And so to do the dose response curve, I'm plotting log Cn as a function of log L. Okay. And so what you get is that for small tau, you get something like this a bit. Relax to tau equals 1 second, say. Tau equals 3 seconds, that would be like this. Okay. And then you start having things like that. So that would be tau equals 5 seconds, tau equals 20 seconds. So you get non-monotonic dose response curve. You get this, it's going up and down and up again. So you could argue that it's an going up and down, it's almost like being flat. It's more like an approximated adaptive sorting. But of course, at that time, I was not aware that flat was a response. I was as stupidly as it might be. I was aware that the optimum thing would be to have no flat lines where you directly measure binding time. Okay? So this model is doing this. And what is quite interesting in terms of biology is that we actually see this non-monotonic dose response curve. So we see that for the agonist ligands, the cells are more responsive at low concentration than at some high concentration. So we actually see this. So this model is explaining that over there, but it's more like a deformation of the ideal solution. And so that's the difference between physics and biology. You know, as a physicist, I actually want even to have, as you described, the vertical line. But biology is not a vertical line. Biology is more like something like that, actually. Something like this, a little bit. So you have like an optimum zone here, which is like mid-range ligand, and then you actually deplete the thing. So that's more like the biological response. So it's a bit like you concentrate your strengths here, your signaling strengths here. Okay. Yeah, I think we'll take some questions and then, yes.
Yeah, so what exactly is the rest of the network doing? I mean, you said that there's like a big hairball network that you see, and this is like a critical part of it.
Yeah, so, well, I believe it's not a critical part of it now. Clearly, we can do the same with a multi-implant network. So I believe all the decoration of the network are kind of not useless, but they are kind of, you know, contingent. We were talking about contingent evolution, that would be more like contingent. One thing that is not useless, though, or at least from an experimental standpoint, is that like this neural network is more organized like this than what like the simple adaptive sorting networks that I described. So this is not contingent, and this clearly has a phenotypic signature. So I don't know if this phenotypic signature is really necessary in terms of biology. I mean, do you really need to have this thing here for the cell to work efficiently? But clearly, the network is doing that too. So, but along this same line, what we did actually is that we ask a very simple question. So now if we take this very complicated network, can we try to map it on a simpler network? You know, change parameters, deform parameters, and stuff like that. And so what we've done, so we took one of these big models. We did not take the big model that I showed you because it was really too complicated. I mean, it was too much for me. But we took a simplified version of this complicated model that still had something like 50 equations and 100 parameters. So it was simplified, but still too complicated for me to understand. And then what we did, we found a good way to modify parameters, modify links, a bit inspired by my evolutionary computation things, to try to essentially optimize the response while, you know, essentially removing stuff in the network and seeing what is happening. So we've done that on this complicated network, and then it actually works beautifully. It works very well. It removes part of the network, so we have like feedback disappearing, we have parallel password disappearing, and you end up with exactly this. You end up with a very simple network, very similar to adaptive sorting, exactly doing this computation. So we are kind of confident that you know, the big network is actually doing the same job as the small networks. It's just making it in a more convoluted way.
So, but related to that, I mean, So let's say you have this particular network, right, and you compare it with the hairball.
Yeah.
So I'm saying, in terms of evolution, for instance, let's say you have this, and there's some kind of a kinase duplication or something. Does this sort of still perform this ratio computation?
If you duplicate a kinase?
Yeah.
No, I haven't tried, but yes, I don't think the kinase is not a big deal, because if you duplicate it, it just adds up. So, and all the catch is that you actually add up things in the denominator. So I think if you duplicate the kinase, it would work. Just to elaborate on this, the true biochemical constraint here is actually that the phosphatase, so here in the full model, the phosphatase is not specific to any of the link. While in the adaptive sorting model that I presented, there is one kinase specific to one of the link. So you could argue that in terms of biochemistry, this is more realistic. You know, phosphatase are not specific. So it makes more sense to have a non-specific phosphatase, and this is what explains this kind of looping here. If you could make it specific, you could make it the line vertical. Of course, you learn that by doing the modeling. You know, it's really like the non-specificity that is creating this this weird thing. But you can imagine, at least yourself, on your pen on paper, you can design adaptive sorting and get a perfectly vertical line. Yes. Yeah. Okay, but then what happens here is that, so in this system precisely, what happens is that when the ligand binds to the receptor, it basically moves out the most of the phosphatase. So there are biochemical things happening at the receptor level that are consistent with this biochemistry that I'm describing. And these things are well known. This is called a kinetic segregation model. People have really looked in detail at what happens to kinase and phosphatase. So this is a case where, in some way, you cannot consider the cell as a well-mixed system because there are local things happening. But on the other hand, these models, which are by and large well-mixed, they work very well because they somehow extract the important parts that are separated and make a model of these parts that are separated from everything else. So that works very well. All of this is working. Yes? Yeah. Yeah. I think a priori it's very difficult. The key thing was to realize that the network was doing this computation, this phase diagram. That was a key thing. You know, you had all this data, but the key thing that it's doing is that it's doing this computation. And so this is a kind of data, this is kind of higher level information that you need. You need to know what is the actual non-trivial computation that your cell is doing. If you give me a computation, then I can evolve a network in the computer to do this computation. But you know, only with data, I cannot tell what the computation is, and it might be very difficult to predict the network. At least I don't know it in a systematic way. So, you know, very early in this my lectures, I told you, you know, biological computation is really what is important to me. This is exactly what that means. You know, if you tell me it does this computation, I can evolve a network doing it, and I can study what the properties of the network are. But if I don't know what the computation is, I don't know. I cannot tell much. I cannot give it to my computer. Because you know, the reason is, if I know the computation, I can find ways to encode it properly in a fitness and stuff like that. And this is why it's easy. Okay. Yes. Okay. Okay, so cost for the complexity. So we don't have an explicit cost for the complexity, but what we do is that when we run this evolutionary simulation, we have mutation rates, and we have it's much more probable to remove stuff or to basically break stuff than to add new stuff. So this naturally limits the complexity of the network because you essentially if you keep something, it's really because it has some usefulness. So, but there, we don't fit in any kind of, we don't say complexity has this cost. It's just we do it this way and then we see what happens. Okay, so for the fitness function. So the fitness function is actually a bit, it's a bit subtle. So, imagine I am an immune cell, and imagine I measure CN, or a complex in the system. So imagine I have ligands presented in the system, okay, and I'm going to plot what is the distribution of CN as a function of CN. So I must say I'm totally agnostic to what happens in the outside world, but what I see is a distribution of CN. So my distribution of CN might look like this. And this would be like for tau, binding time equals 3 seconds. So, I expose the cell to ligands, and then the cell sees this distribution of ligand, of CN at tau equals 3 seconds. And of course, this distribution depends on ligand concentration that I'm presenting. I could present from 1 to 10^5 ligand concentration, but this is a number I can compute. I can assume there is a distribution of ligands, and then I can compute what is the distribution of CN that is associated to the distribution of ligands. Okay? So now that's tau equals 3 seconds. So now imagine I present ligands with a binding time 10 seconds. So then there are two cases. So it could be that the distribution overlap a lot. Imagine this is this. For tau equals 10 seconds, my distribution of CN is overlapping. So this is bad because it means that based on CN, I cannot make the distinction between the two. So this is a bad situation. Because I cannot make the distinction between the distribution at 3 seconds and the distribution at 10 seconds. So there is no way I know if the ligands is 10 seconds, 3 seconds, or 10 seconds. But now if I add, I do the same experiment with a different network. Okay, and then imagine I have this, 3 seconds, and then 10 seconds is like that. Okay, so if my distribution of CN is drastically different when I have ligands at 10 seconds and ligands at 3 seconds, then I can say, well, it's easy, I put a threshold here. I say this is self, this is not self, problem solved. Okay, so our fitness function is quantifying this. It's quantifying if I put some random ligands with different binding times, how much of the overlap there is between the distribution. If there is no overlap, it's really good. I can perform information. It can perform the procession. I can make the discrimination. If there is an overlap, I cannot perform properly a discrimination. And so we encode this using neutral information in the end. So it's a bit subtle because you need to assume some distribution of ligands and then you need to plot this distribution, compute the mutual information. But the idea is really this. The idea is that depending on the ligands you are exposed to, your distribution of CN is going to be different and you want them to be as different as possible. So that would be the mutual information between essentially CN and the binding time. So in this case, the mutual information is basically 1 bit because you can make distinction between the two. In this case, it's less than 1 bit because you cannot make the distinction between the two. I mean, you need to go a bit in the details of what, but that's the idea and so information 1 bit means that you can take a decision. And this is quantified by this. The important thing, so the reason why we do something so complicated is that you see there is no notion of putting a threshold or anything. You know, it's just I want the distribution to be different, and then I figure, you know, my assumption is that if the distribution are different, the system is going to figure out a way to make the decision. Okay? Yes? Maybe last question? Yeah.
I guess in another context in which you could prove this theory is when you see diseases which affect the immune system, right?
Sorry, what? Which affects the immune system?
Diseases, right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Right. So, for example, suppose your immune system stops responding to ligands, right?
Yeah.
Now, that could mean that your tau has decreased, right?
Yeah.
So you could actually go and see in the network what's the weak link, right, which might be causing this, right? And so probably in this context, what is truly happening is that your kinase is maybe, you know, being affected so that you now maybe degrade more closely to the end, so that you now calculate tau differently.
So the answer to this. So how do you test the theory, and do you have evidence like this? So you have evidence like this. So for instance, so this is more like the real network, the phosphatase. SHP1, which is the right phosphatase here, it's implicated in zillions of autoimmune disorder. So if you decrease it, you get autoimmune disorder, which makes sense because it's a negative part of the network. It's what tame you down. So, like, you know, if you look at immunotherapy and stuff like this, when they have troubles, it's troubles very often with SHP1. So that's a kind of meta proof of the theory, but this is consistent. Now you can be a bit more specific. You can take a cell and you can look at what happens in terms of SHP1 level versus its immune response. What we see, for single cells, we see that if you increase SHP1, basically, I still have my non-monotonic dose response curve. If you increase SHP1, what will happen here? So imagine I take this curve, and I increase SHP1. What will happen that you do this? So now if you have a threshold of detection there, what you see is that you lose immune response at high ligand concentration, which is super counterintuitive. It's an immune system that is only working for small ligand concentration and not at high ligand concentration, which doesn't make sense. But you see that exactly experimentally. You see that if you increase SHP1, you lose the immune response only first at high ligand concentration. And then as you increase SHP1 again, you will start, the thing is starting moving there because this curve is going there. And at some point, you completely lose the immune response. So we see that experimentally. So that's one of the tests of the model. And the last test of the model is this antagonism things, because you can be a bit more specific and a bit more quantitative and see exactly where, you know, with the theory you can show, I mean, what is not trivial is that antagonism is maximum somewhere here. And you can test that. You can say, well, antagonism is maximum here. Here you have no antagonism. Here you have strong antagonism, and here you have no antagonism, essentially. And you can test that experimentally, and that works. So, and also there are more like molecular things. So for instance, there are beautiful experiments done by Ron Germain where they took a cell. Okay. And then what you could do is that you could put a not self here. And then you could put an antagonist here. Okay. And then what you see that the antagonist is antagonizing this guy on the other side. So you can show that experimentally, which is consistent with this model. The last thing I have not mentioned is that this theory is probably much more general than simply the T-cell context. And it turns out that we found examples in many other different contexts. You know, it's really a theory of how you make discrimination based on one parameter irrespective of the concentration, and that's a very generic problem in biology. And so we found many other examples than the immune cell. So we think it's a general theory. It does not apply only to T-cells. I think we should wrap up now. Okay? Thank you for staying until the end.